Hi folks, this is David Kwan here, and this is another kind of a long overdue video in that I wanted to do this one right after I returned from my week in Washington, D.C. But, you know, it's been a while. Anyway, it doesn't really matter because I still get to talk about it, I suppose. During the winter break, I wasn't in New York City. I was in Iowa, where my parents recently moved to. And then I was at for a week, I was in Washington, D.C., and then after a week, I came back to New York City, and I'm here now. School hasn't started yet, technically, but internship has, you know, and internship is tied in with my coursework. So I've started my week of internship, and yeah, what I thought was interesting, every place, you know, Iowa, Washington, D.C., New York City, you know, I'm very kind of, my focus in social work really is about kind of the social services and advocacy for the population experiencing homelessness, or perhaps at the risk of experiencing homelessness. You know, homeless services is kind of my stick, or it's quickly becoming, actually, you know, I would say that's like my specialty now, you know, social work for the homeless. And it might be because of that reason that I really encountered homelessness in Iowa, just once, though, really, just encounter. I mean, like, directly, personally, like, kind of witness an encounter and whatnot, and in Washington, D.C., and in New York City, and I have these kind of three separate stories, but it's just, like, I see homelessness, like, everywhere in this country, and I'm sure if I go to a different part of the world, I'll see it there, too, and it's the kind of homelessness that is really most visible. You know, I'm not going around and I'm not seeking out homelessness where it's most invisible. You know, and the thing to keep in mind about homelessness is there's so many misconceptions about homelessness that I don't really understand how it came to be this way, but I also try to understand how it came to be that way. But the myths about homelessness, you know, like when I talk about a homeless person, typically, you're probably going to think of a man, usually an image of a man, of an older gentleman. So this is a very stereotypical image that somehow has become the stereotypical image of homelessness. Old man in ragged clothes with long beard or messy beard with long hair, like he's probably black or Hispanic, and he's probably out on the streets, on the sidewalks, near buildings or near kind of grates where steam is piping up, and he probably has a setup where he has a cardboard box set up or a sleeping bag near him or something. Or maybe you're thinking of a hunched woman who kind of looks a little bit sickly, but like she looks crazy, you know. You think she might be crazy, so that she has a shopping cart, and also she has like a cardboard box that says, you know, it says I'm homeless with need to support my kids, please donate money, and they have cans or whatever. You know, these are the stereotypical images of homelessness in everyday language in mainstream media. For some reason, it's they're the most visible kind of homelessness. If you don't think about homelessness, that's who you meet, that's who you see. But the factually, statistically speaking, there are those kinds of homeless people, the street homeless, the people who are out on the streets, the men with, usually men, sometimes women, but single adults, really. Single adults who are typically over the age of 40. They're in their 40s, 50s, Vietnam War veterans. People like that are the stereotypical images of homelessness, which is weird because it's not reality. If you want to say stereotypical image of something should capture the majority of that something, that is not it. That is a tiny segment of the homeless population are single adults out on the streets. Tiny, tiny segment. Like what? Like 8%. Not even 8% of the entire homeless population in the United States of America are street homeless who are single adults. But that's who I see. You know, that's, so in these encounters that I've had out on the streets, not at my internship, not in any of the jobs that I've had, or, you know, where I did encounter very different kind of homeless people, but in kind of everyday life, not minding your own business kind of thing, these are the people that hit. A more actually accurate stereotypical image of homelessness would actually be, and I made a blog about this on my WordPress site before, and that got a lot of responses. And I was really pleasantly surprised by just how quickly the response that blog has gotten. So people are clamoring to know about homeless. I think that's great. But a stereotypical image of homelessness is not an old, dirty gentleman. They're, you know, they look crazy. They're old, ragged. They smell. They're holding cardboard boxes size and they're sleeping on the street. That is not a stereotype. That is not a, if you want to make a stereotypical image that is more accurate, the more accurate image would be like third graders in a public elementary school. And they're just, you know, they're just sitting in their desk with other students. They're playing, they're learning. That's a stereotypical image right there. The vast majority of the homeless population are children in public schools. Some in private too. But children and families. Mothers, caretakers, grandmothers with their children. So families are the biggest segment of the homeless population. Usually you don't see them on the street either. The street homeless is a tiny minority of the population. Majority are living in shelters, in churches, doubled up with other families or stranger families. You know, that's a more accurate image. Children constitutes like 30% of the entire population. Children under the age of 18. So, you know, and so that's such a significant part. Anyway, the people in Iowa, I encountered, my dad got a new job. I was just kind of aiding him to his new job area. And there's these police officers surrounding this one man. And this one man has a backpack out. And he's just holding it out to the police officer. And the police officer are like searching him. My dad's like, what's going on? And he's kind of worried, like, well, is the police officers, are they going to ask us to kind of search through our backs too when we go in the building? And I look at that. You know, I already have a preconceived notion of what that is. But I'm right, though. Because I've seen something like that many times in New York City. For someone like my dad, that's a very rare sight, I think. So that is pretty much, you know, this homeless man with his backpack that has all his belongings. His life is in his backpack. Having to show to the police officer what it has in his backpack. Because either there are two assumptions that I make about this. You know, the first assumption is that these police officers are being kind of being really mean, and so they just want to like make sure he's not a threat or whatever. That's one assumption. So they want to kind of protect the jobs, the public area that they're in. So they're gonna kick him out of that area. And keep in mind that this was in like late December. So it was freezing cold, freezing cold in Iowa. So he really just has one jacket in the backpack. That's all he has. The second assumption is that the police officers want to help this man. The second assumption is they want to know what he has in his backpack to figure out what he needs and to transport him in their police car to a shelter or to a place where he, you know, his friend's house, something to transport him to a place in need. I want to assume that, but it's not necessarily the correct assumption. It would still be an assumption because I really end up talking with the homeless man. I just kind of passed by. I gave the police officers like kind of a look, like I hope you guys are gonna do the right thing. And then I didn't really talk with the homeless man, but I did kind of nod at him. He nodded back, and I don't know what that means, but it's just. You know, like a lot of these times, I walk past the homeless, and one of the things that kind of, you know, ends up repeating in my mind, like I think to myself, or I say to myself, like my heart beats with you. I say that to myself a lot. It doesn't really mean anything, you know. It just means that, you know, I want to have. I'm not even to claim that I have is arrogant. So I don't know if I have, but I want to have. I'm trying to have empathy for these folks experiencing that in the situations that they're in that I can't possibly imagine being in. You know, it's just I've been spoiled and privileged to not have to really experience or deal with that. But it's something that I just still encounter and witness, and so seeing them, you know, it's sometimes, most of the times, unfortunately, I don't talk, you know, I don't end up talking to them or actually really having a conversation and trying to really help them the best way I can, you know, but that's probably the reality for most non-homeless people. We just kind of go about our lives, and it's when we encounter that, it disrupts our daily routines. But I think it's an important disruption that happens, and that's why I talk about it. In Iowa, it was a disruption that was so quick. You know, we just saw the police officers, the man. I nodded at the homeless man. He nodded back. He looked very sad. We walked past him. And then at my dad's job site, I helped him do like his little checkout thing. We walked back out, the police officers, and he was not there anymore. So I don't know what happened to that guy. I hope my second assumption is true. It's super cold outside. If they just kind of put him in his car and checked him out somewhere, that's just so horrible. But you know, it's the police officers have a lot on their plate. That they you know, they have a lot of job duties, and kind of transporting people like that to the appropriate places sometimes is part of their job, and it's an important part of their job, and it does the community good, you know. So I want to assume that the second assumption is true, that the police officers gave him help. I don't know. I'm not very familiar with how homeless services work in Iowa at all. That's out of my comfort zone. You know, when I'm in New York City, I know how homeless services operate here. So it's a much easier, I mean, it's still difficult in New York City, and I'll talk more about that in the second part to this video, but this, because it's already 12 minutes, I'm going to have to make another video. But in Iowa, it's just like, I don't know what to do. I don't know what hotline to call, what number to call. Like, if I decided to kind of stop what I was doing, you know, walking with my dad to that place, if I just stopped what I was doing and I actually just engaged with the police officers, hey, police officers, can I ask what's going on? And, you know, and blah, 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 all this Spanish homeless, or just blah, blah, blah. If I actually directly engaged with that conversation, I don't think I still would have any idea what to do. It probably would have been more referring to the police officer's judgment. It would be like, oh, okay, well, you know, what are you going to do with this man? Like, blah, blah, blah. And then it's like, okay, well, you know, I would probably make suggestions here and there based on what they tell me, but it would really be based on what they tell me. Whereas in New York City, they could, you know, if I engage with a police officer, they'll tell me what they think they'll do, and then I can actually respond to them saying, well, what you're telling, you know, I can actually kind of have a more informed kind of advocacy for the homeless person, saying, well, actually, I do know a shelter in this area that is much more appropriate for this person. Or how about we, you know, I have a better kind of a, I would be a more powerful and more effective advocate in that conversation if I was in New York City. In Iowa, I'm just like, are there shelters here around this area? Which number do I call? Does 311 operate the same way it does in New York City? I don't think so. It's like it's a crazy thing. Like, you know, and what churches do what? 311 in New York City is a very informative thing. You know, there are some churches that do soup kitchens that have referral services, free services like health screening services, educational services, temporary shelter services, you know, things like that. And it's just so much more resources in New York City for the homeless folks here. Even though it still is a humongous struggle in New York City, which I can't talk about too much, but that's just one of the feeling I had when I encountered a homeless person in Iowa. Just like, I have no idea what the hell I would do if the police officers weren't there and if it was just that person and just that homeless man. You know, I would hope he knows so that I can talk to him as like, hey, you know, I'm pretty new to Iowa. It seems that, you know, you're staying in this place because it's cold outside and you want to stay in. That might get you in trouble. Like, do you know where any place else that you could be so that you don't get in trouble? Like, I would have to ask him that. I wouldn't be able to suggest it. And he hopefully he comes up with it. It's like, well, I have a friend 20 minutes from here, but I don't have a car. And, you know, that, something like that, I'll be like, okay, well, I could drive you there with my dad here. But it's you know, it's kind of those things. I don't know. And in Iowa, that's kind of the thing where just giving someone money doesn't help at all. In New York City, I mean, you could probably do that. You know, it's like, oh, I just need $20. It's like, here's $20, and you know, that person could buy something in McDonald's and have an excuse to actually be sheltered in McDonald's for a while because he bought something, right? That's one. Sometimes that's the reason that people need money in the streets, because they gotta survive the cold somehow. Even though New York City is a very different thing because the city operates in an accommodating way. Whereas in Iowa, I don't know. I have no idea. So that was the kind of experience that I felt. Was like, I have no idea how I could help you. But it's just you're there. I see you. I notice you. I hope things work out for you. That's just the sentiment that I have, that I had in that encounter. There's two more encounters that I want to talk about, which I'll talk about in the next video.